Jesse. Alark is a assistant professor up at Boise State, which is just a little bit north and west of the here. He had Nick coming down and seeing what's going on at FSD to talk over some research ideas. Alark has worked at some of the other places that we all know about. So he got his MS at Stony Brook with Klaus Mueller, did his PhD at University of Maryland, Baltimore County with Penny Rheingans, and then after finishing that up, he was a postdoc in the Department of Radiology at Yale before the deciding that Intermountain West was the place to be. He's going to talk to us about the visualization of vascular structures. I'd like to note that he doesn't seem to be using Smurf blue for these structures, although that's the color of your football field.
Yeah. So I can't get away from that color. Thank you. Okay, thank you for the introduction.
Great pleasure to be here.
So today I'm going to talk about just one project that I've been working on for the last couple of years. And I figured instead of paper spraying you with a bunch of projects, I'll delve into one of these projects that I've worked on. So visualizing vascular structure is particularly important because what happens is that surgeons really don't want to go in for surgery and perform any invasive task. They really want to try and avoid that as much as possible. So the first thing that they'll do is they'll try and put a patient on medication and try and scan that patient over time. The idea is, can you actually automatically register the patients as they come in, look at their data, and quantify whether the patient is getting better based on the medication they are on. So this requires a lot of automated vessel detection, which is what the first part of my talk is going to be on. But it also requires visualization. You kind of have to try and provide visualization tools and visualization techniques so that they can make some sense of the noodle soup that they are looking at. So obviously there are interesting things that they'd like to look at, such as angiogenesis, when your body basically decides, okay, there's a blockage, I'm going to just start growing new vessels around this blockage, and that might be better than having to put in a stent. There might be also a situation where you want to try and look at the characteristics of vessels over time. What are vessels getting bigger? Are they getting smaller? Is there a stenosis? And there is automatic. Okay. I don't even have that. Okay. So, from current spanning. Okay. And so, the first thing, being a visualization person, I said, well, let's do some volume rendering. Let's see what that looks like. And volume rendering obviously has a lot of strength and power, but as we all know, manipulating a transfer function is no mean task, and this is not something that we want to give out to our collaborators in cardiology and say, yeah, sure, just use this transfer function and you'll be able to see vascular structure really well. So we wanted to get away from that. Also, there are situations where let's say you're looking at an aneurysm in a human brain. There is a lot of occluding structure in front of the brain that you really want to try, in front of those aneurysms that you really want to try and get rid of. And sometimes the calcified structure has the same density as the surrounding skull, and if you just use the same simple transfer function based technique, you are basically eliminating important data. Also, as we all know, transfer functions have some issues, like you have a simple step transfer function and then thin vessels with low intensity are going to get eliminated. Well, those thin vessels might be something that you are after, and that's really not going to fix the problem. You might end up causing formations of islands of vessels if you have stenosis, and again, that's not something that you want in a visualization. As most of us know, any medical doctor would not like to see any kind of artifact and then continue to work with us after that. So the first thing that most people have worked on is vessel segmentation. The idea is to come up with an automated vessel segmentation algorithm where you give it a medical data set, a CT scan or an MR angiography, and then you get an automated vessel segmentation algorithm, automated vessel segmentation output. The most of these techniques kind of follow this two-step process. So in the first technique, you try and do some filtering. The idea is basically to detect some kind of tubular structures on a voxel-wise basis. And you can do a bunch of things. You can look at the intensity. You can look at all the usual suspects like gradients, curvature. Try and use some of that to quantify whether a voxel belongs to a vessel or not. And then you can also use global segmentation techniques like level sets or region growing, maybe even Kalman filters, to then use the output from the filtering to segment the entire vascular structure. And so you get some kind of output with global connectivity constraints. It's telling me that it's time for me to move on. So Frangi et al. was the first group to do automated analysis. And what they worked on was they came up with a technique which uses a Hessian analysis to identify a vesselness coefficient. So what is the vesselness for a specific voxel? So they would perform a Hessian analysis and identify whether it was a tube or a cylindrical structure. Now, the underlying assumption is that vessels are basically long tubular cylindrical structures. And so that's exactly what happened. They were excellent at identifying long tubular cylindrical structures, but it didn't really work very well at branch points or in situations where you had aneurysms which are not long tubular cylindrical structures. And so this has kind of still stuck around, and people have made some incremental progress in trying to use the Hessian approach to get better and better segmentation. What we said was, well, let's try and come up with a different way of looking at it. So we came up with a non-parametric formulation to detect these structures. What we would do was, we would basically have an automated way to sample intensities in a spherical neighborhood around each voxel. And we would basically identify something called a polar neighborhood intensity profile, where each of these filters, which are basically these conical filters, would be used. So we would have about 72 filters, and then we would analyze those filters for each voxel to try and characterize the vessel as being part of, a vessel or not. So let us look at how we broke that up. So the output of each of these filters is basically the average square of the intensity deviation. So we are computing an intensity deviation here using spherically separable filters. Now, these spherically separable filters came in very handy later on when we parallelized our code using CUDA. Does anyone know how to turn this off? Because I'm not on rehearse. Well, there is.
Yeah, you go to slideshow transition. Maybe.
And use automated.
And this is click after, turn that checkpoint, just where the mouse is at.
There.
Turn it off, there you go.
Okay.
Advanced line.
Thank you. This is not my PhD defense that I have practiced 20 times.
Is that for all slides or for the slides?
That is a good question. Which was
we'll find slide? Out.
There was a button applied to all slides.
Okay.
Want
to go back? And
sure, let's do that.
So there's nothing like group editing of PowerPoint.
PowerPoint, yeah. We want to.
To the right, apply to all slides.
Thank you. Thanks for putting that. Okay. So basically, for each filter, I'm just going to back up a little bit. It's like Netflix. So for each filter, you would basically compute a deviation, and the deviation would be identified in this form, where I would be the intensity of the voxel at that point. And here we are using spherically separable filters, where we basically distribute or uniformly partition the neighborhood around each voxel into n psi by n phi regions. The idea is to look at a spherical neighborhood around each voxel and use that to classify that box in. So this is...
So how big of a spherical neighborhood?
So our spherical neighborhood, it was just a parameter, so we could go from 3x3 to like almost 9x9 region.
Okay.
So, yeah. So this is kind of the approach. I figured I'd show you some of the approach and then again go back to equations because I don't want to put you to sleep after a good meal. So the first thing is to compute deviation. The second thing is, this was our intuition. What we wanted to do was find tight clusters of the intensity profile. So for a particular voxel, we looked at the intensity profile and we wanted to identify voxels which were part of a tight cluster of vessels. And so the intuition was that close to the vessels, you only have a few sectors and those sectors have a very small deviation. Okay. So now you have tight clusters and we are going to look at how we compute tight clusters in the next slide. And the second thing is that we wanted to compute an entropy of the deviation, which is computed in the second step. And we model this as an exponential probability distribution function to capture this intuition. So now, once you have tight clusters, we can also use the local intensity to kind of say multiply the tight clusters with intensity to get locally bright structures, which are very likely part of a vascular structure. So like I said before, you have these tight orientation clusters. So this is our probability distribution function where we basically have C as our normalization factor, which can be set to a constant. And we use entropy to measure the tightness measure. Now as the entropy gets smaller, the distribution, the spread of our distribution decreases, which then can be used to compute our tightness measure. So we use that in addition to the local brightness around a specific voxel. So we realized that, I mean, we wanted to go for a technique that would work for different modalities, CT angiography, MR angiography, and so on. And so we didn't want to just lock ourselves down to one modality. So to account for intensity inhomogeneities, what we did was we labeled candidate voxels as being locally brighter than the background. Okay, and we defined a brightness function which kind of looks like this, where B of X is a brightness function with S being a sigmoid function and mu's being the mean intensity within the region with minimum deviation, mu, and mu S of which should be max. That's what happens when you copy paste. Mean intensity within the region with maximum deviation. So in some ways, when we are computing the deviation, we don't really have to compute all of these things because we already get that and we can use that in our overall approach. So this is just one slide to kind of talk about how we use CUDA for acceleration. So initially, we prototyped and tested out the algorithm on MATLAB, which took quite a few hours to run. And then we used a combination of ITK and C++ to drop it down to 6 hours. And then with CUDA, we were able to really parallelize our spherically separable filters and bring it down to almost 2 minutes. So this project was actually undertaken by a high school student who worked with me on a summer project. While I was at Yale. So here are some of the application domains. And some of the domains from which we actually got data. So the first one is LAMP, MR, angiography. So what we were trying to do here is quantify vascular growth of tissue for tissue engineering specific vascular graphs. We also looked at micro-CV Odin vessels. This was some work done with our cardiologists at Yale, where we looked at lower limb vascular structure and also looked at heart vasculature to try and automatically identify a coronary tree, which has turned out to be much harder than we thought, and so it's still an ongoing process. And we were also working with some neurosurgeons at Yale who particularly focused on performing surgeries for patients with aneurysms. And so, again, this was a very logical fit where we would get these huge data sets from them with a very small aneurysm, and they basically just wanted to look at the vasculature around the aneurysm. So these were all the places where it could easily work. So the first thing I did was, well, we have this computed vesselness. Let's look at what we get if we just visualize the vesselness coefficient. And so just performed some volume rendering on some sheep heart vasculature. And what we found was that, as expected, the Hessian-based vesselness technique didn't really perform as well at branch points. And our polar-based profiles performed particularly well and was able to identify long tubular structures as well as look at the branch points quite well. But we can still see that we have some issues in terms of islands. Again, this is with hind limb of mice. Here, the yellow arrows show you how our technique actually is particularly good at identifying branch points. But there were situations where our technique also missed out some vasculature. And so we performed a weighted combination of both the techniques, and we found that it performed particularly well as opposed to just using one of them.
So why would a combination pull out features that were not present in either?
No, so it's not so that they're not that, present in either.
The green arrow, right, that vascular structure doesn't appear in the Hessian.
Yeah,
it doesn't appear in the intra-tube base.
Either.
But if you use a combination of those, suddenly it magically appears.
Yeah, so in this case, so we had different parameter settings, and I found that, you know, we could actually do some weighted averaging and increase the opacity of vascular structures that we had already found with, I mean, the vesselness coefficient is just a value between 0 to 1, and we were filtering out lower vesselness coefficients as in previous renditions, whereas in the combination, when we performed weighted combinations, it seemed to show up particularly well. Yeah, I should go and look at it in more detail. I don't know if I should do that well. Okay. So to address the problem of where transfer functions would end up making low thin vessels transparent, we said, well, we already have this vesselness coefficient that we've identified. Why not use the vesselness coefficient and modify the volume rendering pipeline a little bit? So in the classification process, we now use the vesselness coefficient, and we add some depth and shape cues, because that was also one of the bigger challenges that we were trying to address. So using a slightly modified vesselness coefficient, a slightly modified volume rendering pipeline, we increase the opacity of thin vascular structures. So here, on the left is, I'll just zoom in. So on the left is a standard volume rendering without using the vesselness coefficient, whereas on the right, we are using the vesselness coefficient. And we can see that the vascular structures show up slightly more clearly than if you just use a simple transfer function. Now, obviously one of the bigger problems that I have run into when talking to surgeons is that, okay, we can see everything in 3D, you can do a lot of lighting and things, but we really don't seem to get this depth perception. So if you have a volume rendered image, even with lighting, you're not really getting the full, you're not getting any depth cues from it. There has been some work in visualizing vascular structure, and there's many more people who work on these things. So obviously, maximum density projection, trying to extract isosurfaces, or maybe subdividing those isosurfaces and taking some of the connectivity into account, or even looking at some illustrative visualizations to communicate, say, overlaps and things like that. What we said was, let's look at what we can do to try and provide more interesting depth views. So the first thing that we did was, we tried a bunch of volume rendering enhancements, like distance color blending, feature halos, and tone shading. We said, let's see if they are effective, and let's see if they are able to communicate depth in a static image. So distance color blending was proposed by Ryan Vince and Ebert. This is again a technique where on the left you're just looking at a volume rendered image, but then by just applying distance color blending, where dB is basically the distance of the current voxel from the image plane, you can get some particularly good cues that weren't really coming through in the left image there. So now you have, as you mix in shades of blue into the volume rendering algorithm, as it gets further away from the viewer, you get this perception of depth, which you don't really get in a standard volume rendered image. Now, if you add in some of the vasculature or the vesselness coefficient that you've computed, and then use our modified volume rendering pipeline, you actually see that there are certain vascular structures that are actually closer to the image plane, but because of your transfer function settings, they're not really showing up. So what we do is we increase the opacity of voxels which have a higher vesselness coefficient, and that ends up producing images that are able to communicate the, or able to visualize thin vascular structures. We also tried some other techniques for communicating shape. So it's not really a fair comparison, but on the left is just a volume rendering without lighting, whereas on the right is a tone shaded image which clearly shows you some of the three-dimensional structure as compared to the left image. You can obviously try lighting and shadows and all that and see how that works. Feature halos are again a particularly popular technique used for highlighting features of interest, and we use some of those to try and draw attention to specific regions, especially since this is a human brain aneurysm, you kind of want to try and show all of the vascular structure surrounding it. A plain volume rendered algorithm is going to produce something like the left image, where you don't really see the structure of the vessel as it's turning over itself. So this was again quite a neat way to represent the data. So we tried looking at human brain aneurysms, and we wanted to try and see whether we could use some of our vesselness coefficient and visualization techniques to improve the rendering that was shown on the screen. So on the left is a volume rendered image where you can't really see, I mean, you can kind of tell what the spatial relationships are between these two structures, but here it's really not clear. And part of it is just because of the transfer function that you use. You can use distance color blending and increase the opacity of thin vascular structures, and again now you start seeing the spatial relationships come out much more clearly as compared to just plain volume rendering. Tone shading again gives you some of the three-dimensional structure that you don't really get in a plain volume rendered image. So we did all of that. What we also wanted to do was try and conduct a small expert evaluation. I mean, our potential users were neurosurgeons, neurosurgery residents, cardiologists, and radiologists, as well as some technicians who work with these professionals. So what we did was we performed a reference analysis study with 12 experts, 9 males, 3 females, aged 22 to 49. And we basically showed them standard images with volume rendering with lighting, and with distance color blending, tone shading, and feature halos. And we said, you know, which of these two images shows you is best at conveying depth? So our testable hypothesis was that there are you know, the novel ways are more effective at conveying depth. And our independent variable was that the visualization technique was the visualization technique that we were using to convey depth. So we obviously explained the study to the subjects and we can obtain their consent. And then they were asked to pick one of the two images that better conveyed depth. Now, based on the user evaluation, we actually found that distance color blending was most preferred over all of the other techniques that we tested. Tone shading was the second most preferred rendering technique. And halos was actually not at all preferred. Volume rendering without lighting was preferred over it in some cases. So distance color blending pretty much won out in this set of visualizations. So this work is ongoing, and we are actually now looking at exploring different shading models like ambient occlusion and actually looking at whether that might provide improved comprehensibility. It has clearly been used in different application domains, and so we feel like it might be a good fit for visualizing vasculature. Our biggest problem is, you know, can we draw the user's attention to a specific region of interest? Now, you have these big vascular trees, and what they're mostly interested in is the vascular sort of anatomy around the specific structure, whether it's an aneurysm or a stenosis or any of that. And so that's something that we are working on. One of the most obvious things to do is to try and use an octree-based representation, because our data sets are particularly sparse and we can have improved rendering performance if we actually use octree-based representations. So that's something we are already investigating. So I'm actually going to conclude now and say that we, in this project, we basically explored different vascular visualization techniques and tried applying them in a modified volume rendering pipeline. We found that distance color blending actually works best for what we are trying to do and convey depth in static images. Our source code will actually be made available as part of BioMid Suite, which is a open source medical image analysis platform that is an ongoing project at Yale, and I'm kind of working on that too. I'd like to thank people at Yale Diagnostic Radiology, Neurosurgery, and Harvard Neurosurgery who helped us with evaluations as well as gave us some critical feedback about the potential usability of some of these techniques. It's an ongoing project, and we are actually looking at how some other visualization techniques that have been recently published could be used to convey depth and structure more clearly. So with that, I'd actually like to end my talk, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Yeah, so coloring things blue in the distance seems sort of counterintuitive from what you might expect from real life. Have you considered using like depth of field or even like fog to specify depth?
So depth of field is one of the reasons that we're talking with Chuck. And we are trying to see if depth of field might make more sense, particularly because if you're looking at aneurysm, and I've really zoomed in for a close-up. I mean, this is really just a mess when you look at the data set. And so being able to draw a user's attention to a specific region would be immensely useful for, I mean, this is actually even used during surgery because they have image-guided navigation systems, which is a project I'm working on, where they actually can look at 3D data on the screen and use surgical tools to actually navigate to specific locations based on the image-guided navigation system. And so if we can provide a very good way to render detail and draw a user's attention to the vasculature around an aneurysm, it would save a lot more effort on the doctor's part than just showing them all the data. Yeah, I'm not so sure about fog, but it might be worth trying. Thanks.
Once you massage the images and get your region of vesselness and identify that as a parameter, it seems tempting at that point to go back to the segmentation approaches, mm-hmm. and in order to quantify some of this information to generate vessel cross sections, mm-hmm. things that you really can use as quantitative metrics to indeed draw the user's or the viewer's attention to specific locations. Mm-hmm. Have you pursued that direction? You see that as useful?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. One of my colleagues actually is pursuing that direction where they are actually computing these metrics,
right.
And what I think those metrics might be an interesting. It might almost become a feature that we can use to draw a user's attention to.
Right.
So that's a good point. Yeah.
Right. And then what about the whole kind of? I mean, there's all kinds of information that's in a clinician's head about the kind of structure they're expecting to see. Coronary. I can even recognize coronary vessels,
yeah.
pretty much automatically. And so, mm-hmm. so how do you can you build that into your visualization, especially into your guidance system, so mm-hmm. that there are just certain expectations about vessel structure, the kind of vessel diameters you expect in certain regions, the way bifurcations happen. I mean, mm-hmm. a lot of this is very relatively reproducible across people.
Yeah, and so we are finding that actually learning some kind of tree structure based on previous patients is actually quite helpful
right.
to us. And so what we are doing is we are actually trying to extract surface information from these data sets and maybe come up with a statistical model that we can tweak based on the specific patient data that we have so that we don't always have to reinvent the wheel, because many times it's the same data set, so to speak, where you have the, you know, it's the thoracic region or it's a brain aneurysm or something of that sort. I mean, you're not going to get the same structure, but you kind of can learn about bifurcation patterns mm-hmm. and things like that. And so I think that's coming, but it's not there yet.
One of the challenges for this is it's very dependent on protocols and different machines and
yes.
operating them. And you might get it really good from one set of data and then you apply your same techniques to another
yes.
set that doesn't quite work as well. A few years ago, one of Andrew Yennerman's PhD students had a nice paper where they were looking at actually uncertainty for this type of application for volume rendering, where when they were seeing places that looked like stenosis and it really was just an incorrect transfer function. And so they created this just very simple set of animated transfer functions
mm-hmm.
that just kind of stepped through the space of the region of where you would think. And I'm
mm-hmm.
wondering if you could build that in somehow where, given the particular set of data, that you could just actually go through just a few, transfer functions where the person could see and
mm-hmm.
be able to very good detector.
Yeah, exactly.
To where those places don't look like stenosis anymore, and then say, okay, that's my base transfer function. Now apply your techniques on top of that, and
mm-hmm.
then it seems like it might build upon a better
yeah.
starting point.
That I think that sounds like a good idea, particularly because there is no magic bullet transfer function. We might be able to actually give the user some input about trying to identify what is. I mean, maybe someone is actually trying to find stenosis. We want to try and that might actually be quite an interesting approach.
Yeah, you can characterize it from different application, what they're looking at, and
mm-hmm.
it's like, oh, I see what I'm looking at best.
And
these five different transfer functions, and then
this is what
you can highlight even more.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I mean, because we've definitely seen interesting kind of problems with like different modalities, like when you're looking at micro CT of mice versus MR angiography of human brain, we kind of see, our technique is great because now our technique actually doesn't depend, the vessel detection technique doesn't depend on any modality per se, so it works well, but the visualization techniques definitely could use some maybe transfer function gallery kind of an approach. Any other questions? Yeah.
So you've shown that this depth-based shading works best for perceiving depth.
Yeah.
And Timo Rapinski had a paper of his this year showing that directional occlusion shading allows people to see the depth the best.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any comments on those two, since
yes.
they really compare different methods?
So that's my first bullet point, I guess. I think one of the things that we'd like to do is definitely look at direction occlusion shading and maybe some other shading models that are used in the game industry or even are kind of making their way into the visualization literature and see whether they are really, you know, whether they are improving comprehensibility or are they just, you know, applicable to, say, real-time rendering applications. So, no comments, I guess.
So, you know, the final paper that Matthias did is he was going to NVIDIA, it's accepted at Pacific Viz, is combining tubular structure occlusion shading with directional occlusion shading. If you want a preprint of the paper, I'd be happy to give you.
Yeah, I think that sounds like it's right down my alley.
Okay.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Thank you.